morning, church. Welcome to worship here at St. John's Episcopal Church. It's a beautiful day out there today. But talking about celestial patterns, please don't forget tomorrow, if you see darkness, it's not a cloud cover. It is not because it's about to rain. As we all already know, there will be an eclipse of the sun tomorrow as the moon goes over across the sun. And it's advised, do not look up, because it can cause permanent damage to your eyes. Just enjoy the time, and you can see what you need to see on TV, maybe either live or at the 6 o'clock news. Thank God we're here today, and I invite you to please rise up as you are able, and let us sing Good Christians All Rejoice and Sing, hymnal number 205.
Thank you.
is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Together we pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possession, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as many as had need. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we were walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanses us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ourselves only, but also for the sins of the world. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was also called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger on the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Together. Jesus risen, Lord, we thank you for the witnesses to the fact that you rose from the dead as the scripture had promised. We thank you, Lord, that because you are alive, we also shall live, and that you have promised us that wherever you are, so we shall also be. Lord, today we read from scripture how difficult witnessing to the historicity of the resurrection is. We ask you, Lord, that despite the difficulty in narrating this historical fact, you will water the seed that we plant. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, today we read of this resurrection appearance to the disciples. Our scripture today begins by saying, when it was evening on that day. So the first question we're going to ask ourselves, what day when it was evening on that day? Well, the scripture that we read in church on Sunday is broken to what is known in theological circles as pericopes, that is a chunk here and a chunk there, as they surround the story that wants to come out. Anyways, what it means for us then is that we are still on the day of Easter, on that Easter Sunday, the first day that Jesus rose from the dead. Last week we wrote how Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and found it empty. And she was very disturbed, thinking that someone had, or someone or some group had moved Jesus' body. And she went and reported the matter to the disciples. And we read also that day, last Sunday, that Peter and John ran to the temple. And John arrived first, but Peter arrived later because he was a slower runner. But when they got there, Peter went right in, and John also later on followed in. And they saw everything, the empty tomb, the linen wrappings, and the one that had wrapped Jesus' head was on a separate side by itself. And we know that the first witness to the resurrection was Mary Magdalene, because after Peter and John left, Mary stayed there weeping until the risen Christ appeared to him. If we had continued reading on, we would have found ourselves to be reading for today. In other words, what I'm telling you is that Jesus did not come to them 1 week later. It's just that we broke the reading into chunks like that. But that happened immediately on that day of the resurrection, on that Easter Sunday. Some of the things we noticed is that the disciples were still very fearful. I just imagine maybe they have doubled or triple locked the door with lots of wood, something to hold the door fast so that people cannot just easily get in. They were fearful. But the risen Christ is such that even all those man-made locks could not contain Jesus. Jesus came and stood among them. Jesus came even though the doors were locked shut. He was able to get through those doors. And I think it's very important, especially when we read the next phrase that comes from Jesus' mouth. It's important that we know that when the doors seem to be shut in your lives, Christian friends, when things seem to not be going well, every place you go, the doors are shut. There is still room for Jesus. Jesus will still come into your lives and make the difference. And that makes me segue into a very important part there. And that is that Jesus came in, and the first thing he gave them was peace. The shalom. Peace be to you, shalom, in Hebrew. Jesus will enter into your lives when all the doors are locked. And what Jesus brings is peace. And as we read from John's Gospel chapter 14 in his discourses with the disciples, his closing discourse that goes from chapters 14, 15, and 16 of John's Gospel, Jesus said to them, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you." And he said, "Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." What is the comparison between the peace that Jesus is proclaiming to them this day, on that evening, the first day of the week? What is the difference between that peace and the peace that the world gives? The peace that the world gives is the absence of war. That is the peace that the world gives. And it can only be kept as peace when you make weapons of war. As Julius Caesar himself said, "Civi pace, para bellum." Civi pace in Latin, para bellum. If you want peace, prepare for war. If you want peace, prepare for war. That is the peace that the world gives. But the peace that Jesus brings is that inner peace that brings reconciliation, brothers and sisters, in the house of Christ. That peace that makes you not worry. That peace that says there is no more any finger pointing. And it's also important that day, let's not forget, because on the day Jesus hung on the cross, what happened? All his followers ran away. And Peter denied ever knowing or meeting Jesus Christ. I would just fancy, I just imagine when Jesus Christ appeared to them. Maybe the disciples that day were thinking, oh, it must be time for recrimination. Why did you leave me all alone? Why did you run away? Why are you so faithless? But Jesus did not even begin to do any recrimination. Jesus did not finger point against them. Jesus comes and says to them, peace be with you. So that word that Jesus brings, peace be with you, is so all-encompassing. He's not accusing them. He's not recriminating them. Neither was Jesus telling them that you've done such an awful thing. And now, for the next part, after Jesus said this to them, Jesus needed to prove that indeed it was him. He was the one standing in front of them. He said, he showed them his hands and his side. He showed them his hands and his side. And I think that is very important, because before that, maybe they were thinking that they had just seen an apparition. That they had just seen an apparition, a ghost. But Jesus showed them his hands and showed them his side. It was not a figment of their imagination. It was the real Jesus, he himself, standing right there in their presence. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. So it was only after they saw this that they rejoiced. It was not prior to seeing his hands and side. So they got proof positive. They got proof positive that it was he himself, Jesus himself, that was going in and out with them for 3 years since the time of their call until the time of his crucifixion. It was the very same Jesus that was standing there in their presence. And Jesus was there to reconcile himself with them. And of course, Jesus is reconciling the world to himself. He said to them, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. Remember now, we are looking at Johannine theology, the theology of John the Gospeler. We are not looking at the Lucan theology. In Luke's Gospel, the day of Pentecost came 50 days later when the disciples received the Holy Spirit. In Johannine theology, on that very day Jesus rose from the dead, Jesus breathed on them and they received the Holy Spirit, which became very important. Because, remember now, prior to Jesus breathing upon them and saying to them, receive the Holy Spirit, these guys were fearful. The doors were locked shut. And for some reason or the other, I don't know why everybody was so afraid, but Thomas had that temerity to venture out. I don't know, John does not tell us why. Maybe their food was running out. Maybe that food was running out, and they cast lots and they say, Thomas, it's your business now. Go find food for us. Maybe. But I don't know why everybody was so fearful to be out there. But Thomas ventured out. But anyways, Jesus had said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. And I invite us now, people of God, to reflect upon that. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Maybe one or two brave souls here can help us extrapolate. Let us extrapolate upon that sentence. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained. What do we think? Eh? We have to forgive. Yes, I think you both are in the same line. Yes, we have to forgive. Anybody wants to make a little attempt at that? Somebody back there? Yes?
Yes, correct.
correct, yes. Because the Romish church at the time thought they can condemn you to hell if they want to, and they can elevate you to heaven. And we, yes, that is quite right, yes. But also there's a little bit of a comparison there. If you remember, Moses' law was simple. Who knows Moses' law in terms of forgiveness? Moses' law. Yes? An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. An eye for an eye. So there was no forgiveness in Moses' law. Jesus now, and this is why our Bible has the Old Testament and the New Testament, because Jesus has now fulfilled the law of God. Jesus is saying to us, the era of forgiveness is here. And you don't have to be the Pope to forgive sins. Yes, somebody is saying something there. Yes. So what Donald is saying here is also important, because it was in Matthew's gospel where Jesus says, Lord, how often would my brother sin against me and I forgive him? 7 times? And Jesus says, no, I say not that. It's depend on the version you read in. Some say 77 times, others say 70 times 7. And for you, Donald, just because I preached a sermon on that here before, what it is saying is that you don't have to develop a checklist. Okay? Well, I'm not only addressing that part of your comment. Jesus is not saying we should develop a checklist. It means that this act of forgiveness should be so enormous that you have to forgive many, many times. You're not going to say, check, 1 time, 2 times. That is Moses' law, 7 times. Okay? But what we're saying is, Jesus is saying that you can forgive many, 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 many times, that forgiveness becomes a pattern of life. Okay? But in this instance, coming back to today's reading, Jesus is bringing this era of forgiveness where Christians will forgive one another. And I can assure you that if we practice this realm of forgiveness, it does not mean we become a floor mat where everybody can step on us. Jesus is not asking for us to become that floor mat. Jesus is asking that we can pray for the offender. Rather than a place where if you slap me once and I pow, and you slap me twice, pow, okay? And then there will be a lot of deaf people walking around. Yeah. But Jesus is saying, let us practice this act of forgiveness. Just like Good Friday, I said it when I mentioned the fact that in our Lord's Prayer we say, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And in the entire Lord's Prayer, that is the only petition that has a promise, as we forgive those who sin or trespass against us. Anyways, we continue on. Now, we are back now to Thomas, who was called the twin. He was not with them. I've already mentioned that. I don't know why he was not there. If everybody else was so fearful, did Thomas go out to buy some provisions? We don't know. But at least that's the way the story unfolded. So Thomas was not there for that first time. So when he came, the other disciples said, "We have seen the Lord." But what did Thomas say? "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." Let's talk about that one. Thomas's denial. Let's talk about it. What do we see here? Come on now, let's wake up. Let's wake up. Let's wake up. Okay, videre et credere, yes. Yeah. So Carol says, seeing is believing in Latin, videre et credere. Okay? Yes? Mm-hmm. What else do we see? Doubts, yes. That's correct. Come on, choir people. It's human to doubt, yes. Choir people. I'm going to pick on the choir now. When they say preaching to the choir, let me preach to the choir. Let's look at the passage, the very first part of today's passage. There's an answer there. The very first part of today's passage. After he had said this, he showed them what? His hands and his side. So Thomas was asking for the very same thing or things that the disciples saw 1 week earlier. Thomas was asking for those same things. Okay? Thomas was asking for empirical proof. He says, if you had seen his hands and his side and had touched and been with Jesus, let me also see it. I am not going to believe otherwise. What was that? Yes, assurance, yes. Very good, yeah. So, we see that Thomas was not very far-fetched in what he was asking. He was not very far-fetched at all. It's the same things that they had seen. But also there's one dimension that is not in the book, in the reading for today. There's one more dimension. Unless I see the print of the nails and I touch the side, I will not believe. Remember now? Unbelieving Thomas, yes, that is one, yes. And of course, that makes everybody who does not believe anything become a believer, an unbeliever, I should say. Lack of faith, who said that? Yes, lack of faith, quite right. But it showed us one important thing. The difficulty that we all face, the difficulty that all of us will face when we want to preach the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Remember now, Thomas had 1 week. Thomas, who had been in and out of Jesus and had witnessed, I mean in and out with Jesus, I should say, and have witnessed Jesus' miracles, have seen Jesus walk on the water, he would not believe for an entire week. The task for you, Christian friends, is a task of challenge. It's a very challenging task. But Jesus is sending us, as he said in the first appearance, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. The task of preaching the resurrection is difficult. It only can be done with Jesus standing beside us for that person to believe that the resurrection of Jesus is not made up, but it's an historical fact. And that is one important thing. I think John, the gospel writer, included it here for us to know. Not because sometimes, many times when we hear this, we only take one thing and run with it, unbelief in Thomas. That's all we run with. But it's very important that we see the difficulty that you will face, that everybody will face when we say Jesus is risen. Some people might want to laugh you to derision when you want to preach the resurrection. So, Jesus also would like to rehabilitate. Jesus would like to rehabilitate Thomas into the fold of the disciples. He gave Thomas an entire week, but Thomas did not believe. So that 1 week later, Jesus came back and he stood among them and he said, Thomas, come here. Everything you've been asking for, I now give to you. Just like I gave the others before you. Jesus is saying to Thomas, come back to the faith. And therefore, sometimes when we think our faith is faltering, when we think that God is not just there for me, everything I do, I come to church all the time, but I'm always flat broke. I come to church all the time, but look at Mary. Every 2 years, Mary is driving a new Mercedes Benz, and things are not going right for me. Maybe God does not like me, or maybe God just does not exist. But when you feel your faith is faltering, God in Jesus Christ will come to you and will find a way to speak to you and restore you to the fold. Yes, please, Carol.
I noticed in the reading that the first piece that Jesus gave them, Thomas was not there.
Yes.
When Thomas arrived, he said
again,
peace
be with you. Yes, correct. Okay, the greeting of peace.
Sure that they all got the peace.
Correct, yes. Certainly so. He made sure, because otherwise Thomas would have missed out.
Exactly.
Quite correct. We all hear that. So Jesus is always giving us that peace. Okay? No recrimination, no finger pointing. Jesus is rehabilitating us. Despite all our flaws, despite all our mistakes, despite our unbelief, and sometimes we all have some aspect of unbelief in us, but Jesus is always there to bring you back, to strengthen you, to make you continue in your life. So Jesus says to him, to Thomas this time, do not doubt, but believe. And Thomas, my Lord and my God. Thomas really was overwhelmed. Thomas was overwhelmed after really experiencing Jesus. How many times, Christian friends, have you experienced Jesus? And and it's so overwhelming, it's so strong, that you also stand like Thomas and say, my Lord and my God. I'm not asking for testimonies. I'm just asking for you to think back inside yourself, look deep inside. Okay? How many times have Jesus come to you in your sleep? How many times have Jesus come to you in those quiet moments, those moments when you're all by yourself, and maybe you are very busy in your thoughts, deep inside your thoughts, and then when you experience Jesus in a special way that only you can experience, nobody else, how many times has that happened and you stand up and say, my Lord and my God? So today, Christian friends, like Thomas, Jesus is saying to all of us, let us not doubt, but believe. It's okay to make questions sometimes. Even Abraham, the father of faithful people, questioned God a few times. Jesus on the cross said, my God and my God, why hast thou forsaken me? There is nothing blasphemous, there is nothing sinful in questioning. It's okay to question, but don't let your questioning become unbelief. And even when your faith falters, Jesus is there like he was there for Thomas. And Thomas, at the end of it all, says, my Lord and my God. May God grant that as we continue our Christian journey, that we say to God all the time, every time we receive Jesus' presence, my Lord and my God, and may we continue to be a confessing church. Amen.
Amen.
And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before God's footstool of mercy, to the most wise God be ascribed all might, majesty, dominion, and praise, now and forever.
Amen.
Please rise as you are able, and let us reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father.
Came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate of the Virgin Mary.
To our God be the power forever and ever. Amen. Let us appeal to the Lord, saying, "We are yours, be glorified in us." Holy Father, protect your church for your name's sake, so that we may be one even as you are one with your Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. We pray especially for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Mariann, our bishop, Morsal, our supply priest, Diana, our candidate to the diaconate, Dini, our senior warden, Sonia, our junior warden, Layard, our treasurer, and the current members of the vestry. Restore, support, strengthen, and establish us and always for your glory. We are yours. Great God of heaven and earth, you graciously send rain to dry places. Give to the people of the earth enough to meet their needs, and yet protect us from dangerous excess. We pray especially for Joseph, our president, Kamala, our vice president, members of Congress and the Supreme Court, Wes, our governor, Selena, our mayor, and the leaders in the Caribbean, East and West Africa, South America, and Europe. May we acknowledge that all good gifts come from your hand. We are yours. Loving God, raise up witnesses to your love in all the world, even to the ends of the earth. Be patient to orphans, a defender of widows, and a provider to the poor. We are yours. We ask for your thanksgiving for those celebrating birthdays this week, especially Anna Brown, Aldrich Buller Jarrett, Winstina Cole, Cheryl Johnson, Jeffrey Commander, and Folashade Rogers Wright. And for those who are celebrating their wedding anniversaries, we are yours. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Episcopal Anglican province of Alexandria. In our own diocese, we pray for the life and witness of Martin Luther King Jr., April 4th. Chapel of the Annunciation, Church House, the Annunciation, April 8th, all parish altar guilds of the diocese, African Palms, we are yours. Mighty God, in our own community, exalt the humble in due time. May those who have known suffering and struggle have their dignity renewed. Bless them with gladness, make their voices heard in shouts of joy. We pray especially for our presiding Bishop Michael Corey, Mana Abadi, Juliet Adams, Patience Bangua, Kate Bays, Alex Bentick, Evelyn Barnard, Steve Whittle, Samuel Cocker, Phyllis Corey, Faith Davis Ruffins, Judith Davis, Kojo and Elizabeth Dixon, Ralph Dove, Rita Edwards, Mary Ella, Yvonne Iwanga, Carol Fraser, Annie Foster Jones, Avril George, Doran George, Alicia and Victor Johnson, Layla and Jackie Knight, Stephen Lahai, Melissa Lanton, Herman Max, Felicia Marsh, Jean Marsh, Jeremiah and Joshua Messam, Kenneth Melander, Mavella Nicol, Florence Pianim, Joanna Ramsami, Vinolia Roberts, Charlie Roder, Ardy Shears, Gloria Smith, Asha Truce, Dacia and Jacqueline Watson, Amelia Williams, Shitu and Miranda Williams, Gerald Wilson, and Eugene White. We are yours. We pray for our sons and daughters serving in the Ham services, especially Marvette Abadi, James Brittell, Tyrell Chris, Michael Ireland, Ben Johnson, Evelyn Johnson, Nefeli Knight, Priscilla Pilgrim, and Brandon Weeks, and for all our veterans who have served in the armed services, we are yours. Heavenly Father, we have been granted eternal life knowing you through your Son, Jesus. Prepare a home for all of the dying and the dead, that they may continue forever in your goodness. We are yours.
Risen Christ, we thank you for the fact that we can bring our petitions to you, and as you promised, you will always be there to hear us when we cry to you. We ask you now, Lord, to accept these prayers, and even those that we have not offered that may be needful for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, in your will and walk in your will. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please rise as you are able. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I invite all to share our Lord's peace as we do here. God's peace. If you are celebrating birthdays during the course of this week, if you are celebrating anniversaries during the course of this week, and for those with travel plans, we invite you to please come forward for a special blessing. Those celebrating birthdays, those celebrating anniversaries, and those with travel plans, please come forward for a special blessing. Let us pray the birthday prayer. Watch over thy children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passes understanding, abide all days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So let's pray the anniversary prayer as well. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessing upon these, your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and in patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of peace and blessing. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And also we pray together the prayer for travelers. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation, and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, surround them with your loving care, protect them from any danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Safe travel. Safe travel. Through Christ, let us continually offer to God the sacrifice of praise, that is the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. But do not neglect to do good and share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Amen.
Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing the same to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, you do it for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and that the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing. Passover is sacrificed for us. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Together, eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning, St. John's. Good morning, friends and family in the house and online. Happy first Sunday in April, y'all. Wow, we're getting up there. Although it seems winter doesn't want to go away, right? So, that groundhog somewhere. But I can't believe how cold it has been lately, but hey, we're here to glory be, to God be the glory. He woke us up this morning and he set us on our way. So we're here and we give God glory. And we also thank God for our friends and family and loved ones that are online today. Amelia and HB, Mom, Dad, and Charles in Canada, Auntie Dora and Gifty, Jennifer, Lennox, Mother Leela, Mother May, Doreen and Miss Evelyn, Miss Inez, Yvonne Jeffries and Michael Doherty. Thank you all for worshiping with us and being online and sending a shout out. Justina in Freetown. Love to you all. Happy Sunday to you all. Now, do we have any first time friends in the house today? Never ever been at St. John's. This is your first time worship it with us today. Oh, we're all family and friends. Well, we're going to welcome one another anyways, because it's good to be in the Lord's house. So we're going to sing and welcome each other. Awesome thing when brothers and sisters meet together in the Lord's house in his presence to give honor and glory to whom honor and glory is due. Reverend Collier, thank you for today's message, sir. Every time you hear a message about forgiveness, you know, we all get, you know, we think about it, it's like, oh God, he's talking about me. You know, we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but that is why he is God and we are not. So we constantly need him every hour, every day. So thank you for that word, sir. All right, today's announcements. It is here, y'all. The raffle is today. Social and Cultural Committee raffle. It takes place today in the Father Brown Room during the social hour. So if you haven't gotten tickets yet, you're missing out on possibly being a winner, right? Because in order to win, you must get a ticket. We still have a couple of tickets left, I believe. So immediately following the service, either see me or any member, any other member of the Social and Cultural Committee, so that you can grab your tickets before we start the raffle. And again, all the proceeds from today's raffle will be donated to the church. So thank you, thank you, thank you to the Social and Cultural Committee for organizing this raffle and donating all of the proceeds to the church. I hear the treasurer yelling, amen, amen, amen. So it is always good, you know, anytime proceeds go to the church is good, but when you hear 100% of the proceeds go to the church, that's even better. So glory to God. All right, so our Easter lilies, as you can see, the lilies are off the windows. They're no longer in the altar. However, the altar guild has advised us that even though the flowers, the bloom is gone, but the plants still remaining. They're still alive. They're still well. So if you bought a lily or two, please see any member of the altar guild after service so that you can pick up your lily plant and you could replant it at home because the plants are all still alive, okay? So please see any member of the altar guild following the close of service. Mothers Union will meet today at 5 p.m. via Zoom. And all Mothers Union members, please do your best to log into today's meeting. Now, the Mothers Union is also inviting every one of us to their prayer breakfast that is coming up on Saturday, May 25th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. This gathering will feature, and it'll be here at St. John's in the Father Brown Room. And the gathering will feature presentations and discussion tackling the issue of juvenile delinquency. Now, there is a flyer out on the bulletin board because there is a cost to the tickets. Kids' prices have, I believe, it's about $10, and adults is $20. But please check the bulletin board as you exit because there is a flyer posted there, so you will get the most accurate information on the prayer breakfast. But please come out Saturday, May 25th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Nice short event. And let us support our Mothers Union of this parish. The vestry will meet next Sunday following the close of service. And today, as you know, the Sierra Leonean parishioners, please stay. We'll have a meeting today. We are inviting everyone, all of our family, our St. John's family, to worship with us on Sunday, April 28th at 10 a.m., as we celebrate our 63rd anniversary of independence. And then our Guyanese parishioners, who I also believe will be meeting today, if I'm not mistaken, yes? No? Not today. Okay. However, they're also inviting us to worship with them as they celebrate their 58th anniversary of independence on Sunday, May 26th. During the 10 a.m. service. So please mark your calendars for these important dates because this is where the, as I say, we are a church of all nations. And so this is the event where we all get to celebrate, showcase our heritage, and we celebrate our independences. So April 28th is Sierra Leone's celebration, and May 26th is Guyana's celebration of independence. Okay, I believe that is all of the official announcements. Yes, sir.
Just a reminder to the stewardship committee.
Okay.
I'm meeting with Reverend Collier right after the service.
All right, stewardship committee, report to the principal's office. No. Which y'all do? No, I'm kidding. All right, stewardship committee, please meet with Reverend Collier following the close of service in his office. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to say on behalf of the social and cultural committee, thank you, all you, yes, for the tickets, the support of a raffle that supports the church. I hope everyone will be a winner.
Amen. Amen. All right, so it is First Sunday, and y'all know what happens First Sunday. We pick up our second offering. Again, please give generously towards our outreach ministry because this offering helps to fund our outreach ministry. But everyone, so this, we have an exciting week coming up tomorrow, as Reverend Collier reminded us this morning. The solar eclipse is happening tomorrow. That's very exciting. Now, I hope everyone has gotten their special sunglasses, because you know y'all just can't look at it with the naked eye. So please make sure that if you plan to be out to look, to witness the solar eclipse, make sure that you have your special sunglasses on to witness this event. All right, everyone, have a wonderfully blessed week. Be kind to one another and have a blessed one. Thank you.
Accept this gift, O Father, as a token of thanksgiving out of what you've given us. Indeed, now for tell I'm thank you, now for tell Papa God thank you.
Amen.
We ask you now, Lord, to use these gifts as we reach out to our neighbors in you, in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Unto God's most gracious care and protection, I commit you and all your loved ones wherever they may be. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our mass is ended. Our service has now begun. Let us now go out into the world to love and serve the Lord and each other.